Hello and a very warm welcome to a brand new edition of To The Point on Rajya Sabha Television with me, Frank Pereira. The Pathankot airbase attack that was conducted recently, of course, sent shockwaves across the nation and brought back memories of 26/11. There are several unanswered questions after this attack. Could the attack have been averted? What happens now to the India-Pakistan relationship? To discuss that and to analyse it, I have with me former Foreign Secretary, Mr. Kanwal Sibal. Ambassador, thank you for joining us on Rajya Sabha Television.
My pleasure.
Welcome to the show. Could the attack have been averted since we had intelligence inputs and specific inputs stating that the airbase would be attacked?
Let me put it this way. From what I have now read about the kind of security that we had around the base, I think we were vulnerable. And I'm surprised that a major airbase close to the Pakistan border had such poor security around it, because there are buildings which abut the base itself. There are outsiders, large numbers who work inside the base. There are shops, and even the fact that there is this kind of a flyover which overlooks this base is something which obviously detracts from proper security arrangements around a major military installation. So if we had proper security, this particular attack inside the base could have been averted, though the attack could have occurred elsewhere.
Elsewhere, yes.
That is one. The other is that in this case, since we had advanced information of some sorts, and the SP had been waylaid, his mobile has been taken away, he reported to authorities that they were would be terrorists. The fact that nevertheless, they got into the base and they were using the mobile phone taken from the SP, and we were not able to pinpoint exactly where the calls were coming from. From the outside seems to be sure that there is some technical deficiencies in the way we are able to track down these terrorist activities. So yes, on the whole, I would say that we need to step up our security arrangements and take far more pointed, carefully analyzed and implemented security measures, given the fact that this challenge of terrorism from Pakistan is not something new. It's not as if we have been caught unawares.
Yes.
This is the first time or the second time. Even in this area, there have been 2-3 attacks earlier, quite apart from the fact that Pakistan has been abetting terrorism in our country for the last 30 years. So in the background of this, I would say that in a frontier state, close to our border in Pakistan, in the area from where there have been infiltrations earlier, that we have failed to take adequate security measures is a huge and almost inexcusable lapse on our part.
Indeed, a lapse on our part, but then this was not the only lapse. There were several lapses at various levels. How did these terrorists enter into India? And you know, like you yourself rightly pointed out, it's not the first time that it's happened in this particular area. Two such attacks in a span of just 6 months. First it was Gurdaspur and now Pathankot. Do you think that there was an insider's hand involved in this particular
attack? This is what the media is speculating. We also know that smuggling activities are rampant. Drug smuggling is rampant in this area, which can't happen unless there is connivance on both sides. And if that is a basic, flaw in our security arrangements, then anything can happen. Mm. Not only smugglers, but terrorists can come through. Now, the explanation given that in this particular part, there is no fencing because it's heavily, it's an area where there are lots of branches of the Ravi or whatever. Mm. The terrain is such, a very broken terrain, it's very difficult to have a fence there. Now, this is an inadequate explanation as I see it. I mean, if you have such a major problem from a nuclear armed country right next to the border, who's engaged in terrorism over the years against you, and you are unable to block off a few kilometers stretch of vulnerable territory, it is almost incomprehensible as to why we don't do it and why we've not tackled at the base this whole problem of drug smuggling and the connivance that are there on the ground between smugglers on that side and on our side.
Have we learned anything from the 26/11 attacks?
Well, one can say that we have learned to this extent that the reaction was quick. The NSC was sent, other forces at our disposal were mobilized, and casualties were really reduced. It was only in that particular area in the DSC headquarters where the terrorists managed to enter that they killed in the first flush five of our people. But after that, they were contained there. So in that sense, yes, we learned a lesson. They were not allowed to go on a rampage through all the buildings and selectively start killing people. So I would say yes, but the fact that five or six terrorists were able to, be on the news for 2-3 days, and our security forces were not able to deal with them promptly, did create the impression that that our mechanisms to deal with these issues are not sufficiently honed even now, and that we do not have the means and the tactics to deal with such terrorist attacks effectively, promptly, so that the public is reassured that we are up to the task and that we have the dispositions to deal with such attacks quickly and effectively. Now, whether this is a legitimate criticism or whether, on the other hand, from our side, what they say, and I would be inclined to believe that, that firstly, the terrorists were able to enter only 30 meters inside the airbase. They were promptly contained in that particular area which they occupied. And having been contained and having been identified and having been isolated and having ensured that all our assets were safe, then there was no point in acting like Rambos and exposing ourselves to unnecessary casualties. So the idea was to wear them out. Wear them out, even if it took 1 or 2 days, let them expend their ammunition. And once they were worn out and they had lost their ammunition, then attack them and eliminate them. This is a sound strategy because it avoids unnecessary losses on our side. On the other hand, the public perception...
But Ambassador, was that really the case? Because, you know, we seem to have very prematurely declared that the operation was over on Sunday itself, just 2 days into the actual infiltration. But then we got to know later on that there were two others who were still within the airbase, and then the attack continued.
Yeah, that was a lapse, I think. Maybe there was pressure to declare that we had promptly dealt with them and cleaned up the area because politically it was necessary to do so. So maybe somebody jumped the gun.
In your words, did someone act like Rambo then?
No, I don't think so.
And jump the gun and say that, you know what, we did it.
I don't think so. I think clearly this was a mistake, and it has been recognized as a mistake. And it clearly gives ammunition to critics to say that, look, you are again failing in your task to deal with the terrorists effectively, which might be a legitimate criticism up to a point. On the other hand, if something was prematurely declared and then it was retracted, it's all right. I mean, one need not make this the central argument for our failure to effectively act against them. Though, yes, it is a point of criticism which is embarrassing.
That's not just the only point, because, you know, there are several media reports. Of course, we can only go by media reports right now because it's still, you know, nascent stages in the investigation process itself. You know, several media reports suggesting that we were not aware of how many terrorists actually had infiltrated into the airbase. You know, some said 4, some said 5, some said 6, and then eventually we got to know that it was 6 and not 4 as was, you know, first decided.
Well, I have also made this point to people concerned that our media management has been poor. Now, you know, these terrorist attacks from Pakistan is a very sensitive issue, and especially in the context of the initiative our Prime Minister had taken to renew the dialogue with Pakistan, it became all the more sensitive in terms of public perceptions, because there is always this business about should we have a dialogue with Pakistan if it continues to provoke terrorist attacks against our country. So in that context, media management was very, very necessary, proper media management. Now, in this case, there are too many leaks, too many people speaking to the press from unnamed sources, and that's why this confusion got created, whether they are 4, whether they are 6. Now, if we had one single point of briefing the press and daily briefings at a particular hour, more than one if necessary, to very carefully and correctly tell the public what the evolving situation is. We might have avoided this kind of speculation, which was generated clearly because of leaks from these so-called sources and created public confusion. Otherwise, why should the government itself say, I mean, responsible people, that there are four or there are six, or allow an impression to be created that they don't even know how many people there are? So clearly, there has been a lapse in proper media management.
And, you know, could this lapse have been better addressed if a particular ministry within the government had taken the onus upon itself and said, you know what, we're going to take charge, and then everything that's going to go out now is going to go through us? For instance, this attack was carried out on an airbase. So what is the general protocol? Shouldn't it have been the defense minister's, you know, area of operation? Shouldn't he have been there taking care of whatever it was that was happening there, rather than the home minister? Because it was not a matter of internal security, but it was an airbase that was attacked.
Well, I've seen this criticism in the press that the Home Ministry, in fact, was kept out of the loop. And the commander of the air base, that's Sikh officer, I saw his briefings on the television. So there was some kind of I won't say centralized briefing, but briefing by the Air Force, and in that sense, somebody from the defense side. But yes, you're right. We need to work out a proper system where we have to see whether in such instances the central point of briefing the press should be the Defense Ministry or the Prime Minister's office or the Home Ministry. Clearly, the way I would look upon it is this, that since this attack occurred, it potentially could have been very serious.
Yes.
If one or two of our planes had got destroyed, it would have been tremendous pressure, not only the government to break off the dialogue, but also perhaps to do something else. And therefore, acting with promptitude was imperative.
Talking about breaking off the dialogue, now let's move on and talk about that. What happens to the ties between India and Pakistan? Of course, the FS level talks are just a couple of days away. But then, do we see that going on as scheduled, or should we continue engaging Pakistan?
Well, the way I look at it is this, that the Prime Minister's initiatives recently towards Pakistan did cause surprise, because it did not seem to be flowing from a visible improvement of India-Pakistan ties or steps by the Pakistan government to justify this kind of an initiative on our side. And number two, it seemed also to be inconsistent with what we have been doing in previous months with regard to Pakistani provocations and our compulsions then to break off the dialogue. However, one can understand what the Prime Minister did if what he had in mind, as I believe he might have in his mind, is that Pakistan is gaining some kind of diplomatic advantage internationally by claiming that it's ready to talk. But India is rejecting dialogue. So India is being put on the back foot. Because we have experienced over years that there is really no sympathy or understanding of our position on breaking off the dialogue when terrorist attacks occur. Because all those who have been traditionally supporting Pakistan, in fact, make it appear as if India is being unreasonable. India is the bigger country, the stronger country, and should therefore take the initiative. And they're at the back of it. They are worried that if tensions continue to remain between India and Pakistan, they are two nuclear armed states, and somehow there is a possibility that this might erupt into a nuclear kind of a clash between the two countries. So the Prime Minister may have reason. Let's take away this argument from Pakistan. Let me actually go beyond that and express my goodwill in a dramatic manner to Pakistan, so that I firmly place the ball on Pakistan court, and I tell the international community not only that I'm willing to talk, I am willing to change the course of history if only Pakistan would cooperate. At the same time, and I hope this is the case, the message is also going to Pakistan that their mischief will be countered by robust actions on our part on the ground. We may not declare them, it's not even wise to declare them, But if they are happening on the ground, Pakistani authorities would know. So therefore, it will be a question of a carrot and stick. Earlier on, there was only a carrot and there was no stick. So this time, I hope that there is a stick. And if there is a stick, I would then say that this is, in a sense, clever strategy, but on the presumption that there is a stick.
Okay. Interesting what you said, you know. So then, am I to believe that, you know, all this is happening because one of the reasons could be that there is a lot of external pressure on India so as to ensure that dialogue between the two countries continues?
No. This pressure business I don't buy, because when I was in office, I have some. And we were vulnerable even then. Terrorism was still at its height. We had our troops massed on the border. In fact, the Syria situation was far more serious, and we had all these guys from the United States and the European Union coming periodically and engaging us. There is as much pressure as you're willing to take. If you are a concrete wall, there is no pressure. If you are rubber, then there is pressure. It is up to us. Yes, we are part of the international community. We can't live in isolation. We have lots of equities with the United States or others. But look at Pakistan. Despite the fact that it acts in a rogue way, it has actually been responsible for the killing of US and allied soldiers in Afghanistan. It is supporting the Haqqani group. It has supported the Taliban. It has blocked NATO supplies at times. In fact, they have played with the United States, and they don't seem to be under any pressure. In fact, just before Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif's visit to Washington a few months ago, the Pakistani Foreign Secretary went on television or wherever he did, had a press conference to say that they are developing tactical nuclear weapons and they'll use them if required. They don't feel any pressure. So why do we feel any pressure? Because we are on the right side. We are the victims. Why should, as victims of Pakistan terrorism, we feel pressure? I think what the Prime Minister and others may have had in mind is that as part of our engagement with the United States, we are willing to listen to what they have to say. But what we do will be based on our independent decisions and judgment about what we should do in terms of either breaking off or not breaking off or resuming dialogue with Pakistan. So I don't buy this theory, but yes, the United States does make demarches, does publicly urge India and Pakistan to continue the dialogue. But look, the United States has not solved a single problem in our area, right from Morocco to Bangladesh. What have they achieved? Absolutely nothing. They, in fact, worsened these problems. So what is this business of the United States playing a role in resolving India-Pakistan issues? On the contrary, the U.S. has a great responsibility for actually the kind of problems that we today face with Pakistan, because they've been backing Pakistan over the years, and even now they are ambivalent and equivocal with regard to Pakistan's conduct towards India.
You know, another aspect that I wanted to talk to you about is that every time heads of state, both India and Pakistan, got closer together, and every time, you know, the dialogue seemed to be moving in the right direction, there has always been an incident like a Pathankot happening either on the border or within India's borders. So do you think that this is something that, you know, the people who do not want peace between the two countries are doing on purpose? Is this some, an operation that you, is there some kind of a link that you see to this?
No. This is a wrong analysis that I find is being made on our side. Not only in the media, but even those who've been involved in our Pakistan policy. And I'm always perplexed as to why they take this line. This, you know, General Musharraf and others have publicly said, just read what they've been saying, that they use these militant groups, these terrorist groups, as an instrument of their overall policy towards India. It is a considered Pakistan policy that India will not come to the table. India will ignore Pakistan. India will refuse to discuss Kashmir or any other issue. Now the water issue has become important. If Pakistan was simply to plead for negotiations, but if Pakistan has an instrument in its hands, which India is unable to deal with, and demonstratively unable to deal with it for so many years, then continue to use that instrument against India to keep the pot boiling, to push India towards negotiations and yielding on core issues like Siachen or Kashmir, etc. So this is part of an overall policy by the Pakistani state against us. So it's not as if people sitting in Rawalpindi or in Islamabad have their hearts in the right place, but there are some unnamed elements who don't want a dialogue. No, it is a very clever Pakistan policy where at one level, in order to get the backing of the international community, they talk of dialogue, and at the same time, they use these instruments against us to continue to put pressure on India, in fact to humiliate us, because a large country with so much armed forces and nuclear armed power, we are unable to deal with this issue because we fear escalation and we fear that Pakistan may actually raise matters to such a stage that the escalatory consequences would be unpredictable and unbearable. So it's a very duplicitous policy by Pakistan. So I totally refute this view that somehow Pakistani government is helpless and there are some agencies and groups which are there to disrupt our dialogue.
You know, several people in the media and even others believe that the right way to deal with Pakistan is to carry out, an attack like the US did to kill Osama bin Laden, Operation Neptune Star, I think it was Spear, I think it is what it was called. Is that something that India should consider, or is that something that we can do? I mean, or is that something that is too far-fetched?
Two things. If you're not able to seal off our borders effectively and prevent these kind of attacks that periodically occur, and now if, they are occurring in Punjab, they are occurring outside Kashmir, so the yes. Pakistanis have raised the ante. The first action is there. Once we are able to do that and prevent terrorists from entering, and the moment they enter, we deal with them effectively and finish them off, our problem is more than half solved. Then there is no need then to go and attack the bases of these terrorists or whatever inside Pakistan. So that's where the first action should lie. But assuming that it cannot be hermetically sealed, because we can't put a foot soldier every few meters, and given the nature of the terrain or whatever else, or they can come through Nepal or Bangladesh or Sri Lanka or Maldives or wherever else, that these attacks can occur, then what we have to consider is what action we take. Then the action has to be proportionate. It cannot be disproportionate, otherwise we'll land into difficulties in explaining to the international community, unlike in the case of Israel, which has the solid backing of the United States and the West, we can't do it. Secondly, we are not the United States of America. The disparity in forces between India and Pakistan is not the same as between Pakistan and United States. And if United States wished, tomorrow it can bring Pakistan down on its knees, as it has done in the case of Iran. India doesn't have the means. I mean, supposing we actually, if we were enjoying the same kind of financial power as the United States does, we can just squeeze the Pakistanis out of the international financial system like the US did with Iran. We don't need to use military means. Therefore, we should be realistic. I mean, this kind of bravado that we should go and attack Bahawalpur or do something else. But yes, there's something else we can do. Two things. One is that we don't have to announce the time and place of what we do in return. There are so many internal fissures in Pakistan. We could have a policy of exploiting them, and I would dearly hope that the government is thinking along those lines. And number two, that if a major attack takes place, our proportionate response should be in that part of Jammu and Kashmir, which is in the illegal occupation of Pakistan, which is essentially our territory. And we can take action there in terms of destroying infrastructure or whatever we think are legitimate military targets.
Stern action on the ground if there is some kind of, another similar terrorist attack within India, and of course, should the dialogue continue then with Pakistan? Should we continue engaging the civilian government?
Is that the right way forward? I would say that, to be fair to our Prime Minister and to his dignity and to the maturity of the way in which we should deal with foreign policy, now that he has taken the initiative, irrespective of, we may have different views on the sagacity of that initiative, but now that he has taken that initiative, we should give him room to engage Pakistan if he thinks that the response from Pakistan on the Pathankot incident is satisfactory enough initially to be able to justify the renewal of the dialogue. But as I said, this will not make any sense if we didn't have the second arrow in our quiver, which we should be willing to use, which is to pay them back discreetly without announcing it, but sufficiently, that the Pakistan side should be aware that what is happening is a part of a riposte to their terrorist attacks against India.
Ambassador, we've run out of time. It was a pleasure having you on the program. Thank you so much for being with us on To The Point.
My pleasure.
That's all the time we have. Thank you so much for watching. See you again next time.